Extremely well. Ian, congratulations, and floor is yours.
Thank you. I'm never going to let David introduce me again. I love David. I do. We've known each other for like a long time, and it belies how young I ostensibly am. And he looks younger because he's got his hair cut, but he's older than you think. And thank you very much, Juleanna, for hosting us. It's a beautiful house in my neighborhood, and it's wonderful, and I got to meet the family, and I've been hearing about her and the salon that she hosts that all of you know. And I'm delighted to be a part of it. It is very august company. Look, this is, you're not here for a speech, but you can't get away from a book party without the author saying a few things. So let me say a few things. The book is not called the G0, but for all intents and purposes, it is about the G0. What do I mean the G0? I mean that we no longer have a world of U.S. leadership. Nor do we have anyone else that is actually playing that role. The world of U.S.-led global institutions is over. We will either have U.S.-led institutions that aren't global, or we'll have global institutions that aren't very effective, that aren't U.S.-led, or we'll have neither. Right? We have to make that decision. How did we get here? I think we got here in a combination of two ways. First of all, the underlying balance of power shifted dramatically away from the United States and the developed world towards a bunch of other countries. Fareed Zakaria calls this the rise of the rest. I love Fareed. It's wrong. It's not the rise of the rest. If it were the rise of the rest, we wouldn't have this problem. It is the rise of the different. It is the rise of the other. It is the rise of a bunch of countries that don't agree with us on many things. It's not the rise of the evil or the bad or the maligned or the countries we don't like. It's just countries that we cannot come to common agreement for a bunch of good reasons. They're poor. We're all wealthy, right? They have much more political instability. We frankly don't. Some of them have completely different political and economic systems, state capitalists as opposed to free market, or hybrids as opposed to free market, and authoritarian as opposed to democratic. You put them all together, it's not just a matter of more numbers. It's a matter of being unable to actually come to common ground. That's one reason, is the rise of the other. The second reason is that we're not prepared to do it. Increasingly large numbers of Americans do not believe that we benefit from being the world's policeman. Do not believe we benefit from being the leader of last resort. Do not believe we benefit from a system of US-led globalization. It is clearly a problem for the United States. When we sign a deal in Afghanistan, we will leave in 2014. It will clearly be a problem for the U.S. if Afghanistan then falls apart, as most of us expect it will. I assure you it's a much bigger problem for the Afghans. It's a much bigger problem for Pakistan. It's a much bigger problem for India. It's a bigger problem for China. And yet, when I was speaking to Chinese policy leaders in Davos this year, and I told them, I said, you know what, the Brits did Afghanistan, and the Soviets did it, now we did it. Isn't it your turn? and their response, as my mother used to say to me as a child, was not no, but hell no, because I was difficult as a child. She said that a lot. The Chinese are not going to do this. They're not going to provide the same level of support for Pakistan. I mean, you know, Syria blowing up, and now the war is spilling across its borders into Lebanon, as is very clear, and perhaps Turkey to an extent. And if the United States does not take the lead in fixing this, and for those of you who didn't see Politico yesterday, David Gordon and Steve Krasner, two brilliant, brilliant guys, had a great piece on some things that the U.S. might be able to do to help really pressure Assad. But absent that, and absent anything else, he's going to be there for a while. And the violence is going to continue, and it's going to continue to expand. And yeah, that's a problem for the U.S. It's a much bigger problem for Lebanon and for Turkey and for Saudi Arabia and for Qatar. This is the environment we're in. I think we are facing a period of geopolitical creative destruction. Right? We experience creative destruction in the marketplace all the time. If you have an independent bookstore and Borders or Barnes & Noble comes along, you adapt or you die. And then Amazon comes along, you adapt or you die. We're used to this in the private sector, maybe not in Washington, because nothing dies in Washington. Outside of Washington, we are used to this, right? And yet, in the geopolitical environment, we never see creative destruction because after World War II, it was the United States and its allies with a whole bunch of institutions that reflected our priorities, our values, our sensitivities, and our sensibilities, right? And that continued for decades. It's over now. I think that while the G0 was coming for maybe 30 years with the rise of the different, it only hit in approximate way in 2008 with the financial crisis. But then it hit in a big way. I love the concept of the G20. I really do. I would love it to work. Paul Martin called me, the former Canadian Prime Minister, who I start the book with, called me last week after finishing the book. He said, do you really think the G20 is a bad idea? Do you really think it isn't going to work? I told him, I'd love it to work. I would. I would love for a Doha round on trade to work. I would love that. I would love for any global climate summit to work. I would like a pony for Christmas. None of those things are going to happen. How many global summits on climate do we need to have before we understand that we will not get anything out of a global summit on climate? Does that mean we don't care about climate? No, not necessarily. But it does mean if we want to do anything, we have to find a smaller group of countries that are like-minded that can actually move the ball. The G20, from my perspective, is not just herding more cats, which would be harder, but it's herding cats and animals that don't like cats. That's not herding, right? That's a fight. And that's kind of where we are. So that's what I think the G0 is about. One final point. I don't think the G0 is with us for long. I think absent global leadership, crises do not get responded to. They get larger. Eventually, something else comes in its place. What is that something else? I don't know the answer. But I make a guess. I make a bet. Because I think there are two things you need to answer. The first is, what's the U.S.-China relationship? World's most important relationship, bilateral, two most important economies in the world. Right now, U.S.-China 1 and 2. At some point, it will be China-U.S. 1 and 2. Is it a more conflictual relationship, or is it more harmonious? Answer that question. That's number one. Number two, how important are other countries? In terms of global outcomes, do other countries matter? Will they move the needle, or are they largely secondary to whatever the U.S. and China ultimately decide or don't decide? If you can answer those two questions, you have a pretty good sense of what comes after the G0. Now, since the G0 started, 2008 financial crisis, we had it 4 years, almost 4 years. Could we make a bet on the two outcomes? I think we can. I think we'd make a fairly strong bet that U.S.-China is getting worse. And everyone I talk to in the White House agrees on that. And Romney clearly agrees on that, certainly politically. And secondly, I'd make a fairly strong bet that other countries are going to matter a lot. I'd make that bet in part because the U.S. and China are going to be more inward-looking than they have been historically, but I'd also make it because I don't think Europe falls apart, but I think India becomes more important, and other countries like Brazil and Turkey also play a more significant role. If I'm right about those two things, I may not be, but if I am, then the kind of world we will be moving towards is not one that has a new kind of global leadership. But it's a kind where regions will become much more important. And this is not a series of globalizations writ small, because regions in different parts of the world are radically different from each other. Europe is driven by political and economic values that are in common. And they're largely voluntary, and they're largely rule-based and institutionalized, right? For better and for worse. You go a little bit east to Eurasia, it is completely different. Integration is driven by Russia. It is driven by energy and security relationships to Russia. It is more coercive. It is much more opaque. You go to Asia, and economics drives you towards China, but security drives you towards the United States. And the ability of countries to continue to balance that over time will be problematic. Final point, the Middle East is the most problematic in the post-G0 world. Because absent the United States doing the lifting, with the Europeans distracted, the Japanese on the sidelines, and the Russians and the Chinese playing only for very narrow self-interest, who does the integrating in the Middle East? I can think of a few countries. Saudi Arabia, Iran, Turkey. What do those countries want? They want completely different things. The Saudis support Sunni Arab monarchies. The Iranians support largely disenfranchised Shia populations. The Turks, closer to the Saudis, support more secularized, urbanized middle classes in the cities. If that's what's driving integration in the Middle East, it's driving fragmentation in the Middle East. It is much more sectarian. It is much more problematic. And that it does not surprise me that if you look at the Middle East today, that the trajectories of most countries across the region are negative. I suspect that's not going to change. The pivot of the United States towards Asia reflects that to a degree. Of course, it requires us to redefine Afghanistan and Pakistan as part of the Middle East and not Asia, which is probably smart. But that's kind of where I think we're going. Final point, I promise. The United States is not a loser in the G0. And the United States isn't a loser because in an environment that is vastly more risky, you don't focus just on growth, you focus on stability and resilience, right? I love to say, if you're a camper with other campers, you're being chased by a bear, you don't have to outrun the bear, you have to outrun the other campers, right? If you're swimming and there's a shark, you don't have to outrun the shark, you have to outswim your sister, right? I've got many of these. And in this environment, the United States is seen as much more of a safe haven. Even Japan is seen as much more of a safe haven in this environment, and we'll drive people to it. The danger, the final danger, I can't end on an up note, the final danger, of course, is that we have a safe haven curse. You've heard of the resource curse. Countries have lots of stuff they can take out of the ground. It means that they don't engage in political and economic reforms that are long-term necessary. The ability of the Americans to forestall necessary political and economic reform on things like the deficit is greater because of the G0. We just had an S&P downgrade. Did it matter? No. I mean, to S&P it mattered. I mean, it looked stupid. But for everyone else, it did not matter. S&P, do it again. Right? Watch how much it doesn't matter. Because our political leaders can do the minimum for longer than we would like because of the G0. I think that's unfortunate. I wish we could get out of that trap. Most countries that have resources don't avoid the resource curse. We haven't seen many countries with the safe haven curse. We'll see how the United States does. But at least for the short term, there's not the same level of urgency, precisely because the U.S. is not a loser in the G0. Thank you so much for attending. I feel very much at home here, and I will now return you to drinking and festivities. Thank you.